Prescribe natural fire. Wildland fire use. Fire management for resource benefit. The names have changed, but managing naturally ignited wildfire has always been an important tool. From reducing hazardous fuels, promoting wildlife habitat, and improving forest health, wildfire plays vital roles in many ecosystems. Our federal fire policy may be finally catching up with what land and fire managers have known for decades. In February 2009, the Fire Executive Council approved an update to the 1995 and 2001 federal fire policy. The new policy allows management for multiple objectives on the same wildfire and allows managers to change objectives as the fire spreads across the landscape. Also, the terminology of fire was simplified. We no longer speak of wildland fire use and suppression fire, just wildfire and prescribed fire, planned ignitions and unplanned ignitions. In the spring of 2012, 3 years after the guidance was issued, we spoke with managers in northern Arizona about how the 2009 guidance has affected fire management.
Our example would be the Point Fire, which was on the north rim of the Grand Canyon last year, and it was managed for multiple objectives, and those objectives changed throughout the life of the fire, which was probably about 8 weeks. What the new policy helped us do was be able to change those objectives. So the fire started small. We had almost all resource benefit objectives at that time. As new issues came up, habitat issues, or size of fire issues, or park closure issues, we were able to include other protection objectives into that list of objectives to manage that fire.
We had the Saffron Fire at the north rim of the Grand Canyon. Instead of setting up a maximum manageable area, we established a planning area, and we could identify on that planning area boundary objectives relating to either a resource objective or a protection objective. So it gave us that flexibility that on the park side of the fire, we had a more centered focus on resource objectives, allowing fire to play its natural role. Yet, as that fire progressed to the north and moved on the Forest Service property, we were able to stay within the confines of our land management plan for the forest and set up a protection objective. So multiple objectives on various sides of the fire. And that policy gives us the flexibility to do that.
It helped because of the ability to do what's right when it needs to be done, instead of just going to the next ridge, go to the best ridge.
I think it's a big positive step. I think a lot of programs were afraid to manage fire for resource benefit. They were suppression-oriented programs for 100 years, and it was hard for them to take that leap from putting all fires out to really allowing fires to do everything and anything that it wants to do out there. Now we've kind of meshed that together, and now I think people are more comfortable being able to take actions to contain parts of the fires and other actions to let that just monitor that fire and let that fire grow and do what it's going to do on other flanks of the fire. So that's really been a huge step in the right direction, I think, overall for all the programs out there.
I mean, it took us 110 or 150 years to get to the point we're standing in right now. We're not going to get out of it in 4 or 5 years. It's going to take time to get where we're going. The policy we've got now is giving us that option to move in that direction.
Now, we know there's a lot of acres out there to treat, and we'll never do it just thinning alone. We'll never do it prescribed fire alone. And now we're just bringing wildfire more into it. So now it's another tool that we'll have.
There was a few years ago in 2009, I believe, we had a banner year, and we treated almost 25,000 acres with just wildfire, in addition to about 20 with prescribed fire. So that piece of the pie, the wildfire end of things, has increased, and we're hoping it continues to increase.
Getting fire back into the ecosystem is going to return it back to more historic states, where we should see more grass, more forbs on the forest floor that are now covered by pine needles and young trees. And the openings and stuff in the canopies like that should, you know, help the diversity of wildlife and all the stuff that we're seeing suffering a little bit with the exclusion of fire over the last 100 years.
In the decision process, what we would do is we'd sit down and we would anticipate, okay, what is this fire doing now? What will it be doing tomorrow? What would it be doing a week from now? And if we allow that to burn and provide some resource benefit, what's it gonna be doing a month out? And if we're in one of those low frequency, high severity types of fuel, then part of our decision is, okay, well, we need to be looking further out. Is it going to continue to get dry? And is it going to get to the point where we don't have the upper hand to contain this fire before it starts creating these high severity patches?
And one thing that we did on the Horseshoe 2 fire this year was we knew the fire was going to come down into the canyon that is a world-renowned burning area. We knew it was going to come in there. We couldn't stop it because of the terrain and the fire behavior and the fuels conditions that were in there. But what we could do is we could manage the fire in such a way as to minimize the acreage that was going to be affected by high severity fire. We set up the objectives in our burn plans and in our burns that we were going to put on the ground to drape fire over the landscape rather than let it run down to the bottom and go to the top of the next ridge. And that works really well. But you have to know up front that there is going to be areas where you have no choice. It's going to be high severity.
Just plain old wildfire being managed for different objectives or multiple objectives is easy for me. Okay. We're still trying to come up with the exact message to give to the public and our line officers. But for me, that's a lot easier, just having one type of fire.
Everybody manages every fire for multiple objectives. They could all include all suppression objectives, but there are more than one objective to every fire. I think we need to get away from saying that we're managing this fire for resource benefit objectives and we're managing this fire for suppression objectives. I'm pretty sure both fires probably have resource benefit objectives and protection objectives on both fires. And if we accept that, I think it'll be easier for the public to accept.
Probably the largest limitation we have is just what the fire season's doing, not only on the Coconino, but nationally, and we have to make sure before we implement that we're gonna have a sound plan, and we're gonna be able to back that plan up with resources. And if fire's going nationally and the preparedness levels are up, then we probably aren't going to go out on a limb and manage too many fires, knowing that our plan might not be doable without the resources.
We gotta get better at our smoke impacts. With this new 2009 policy and the way fires are being managed, we're seeing more fire on the landscape out there. That's a good thing, but every fire is going to create smoke, and that's been one of our biggest concerns right now, is we're trying to do this stuff for the health of the forest, yet we got to make sure that we're also providing for the health of the public.
We need to provide assistance for those managers that are taking those risks to manage those fires and to let those fires grow for the benefit of the resource. We got to make sure that those fire managers know that the forest level, the district level, the regional level, and the national level folks are behind them. And if something happens, they're going to step right up and be behind them. There needs to be some accountability for those folks that don't take the risks as well. Right now, I think we have a management culture where if we don't take risks and nothing happens, the people move on with their career and everything's great. But what they leave behind is a pretty risky situation in terms of fire.
While smoke impacts, the growing wildland-urban interface, and the inherent risk of wildfire will continue to challenge fire managers, there is now widespread recognition of the value of restoring fire's role in many ecosystems. Fire teams in northern Arizona and across the Southwest are taking the lead in managing wildfire for multiple objectives, and their insights will provide important lessons for the development of future fire policy and for passing the torch of wildfire management to the next generation.